Let us discuss attenuators. What are attenuators? So, as the name suggests, attenuator is a particular device which is doing the job of attenuation. What do you mean by attenuation? Attenuation means suppression or reduction of magnitude. Magnitude of what? Either the current or the voltage of the circuit. That is the meaning of what that is meaning of attenuation. So here is shown a waveform, right? So we have an input. If that is given to some attenuator, what we could get is an attenuated output, an output which is suppressed, right, in magnitude. An output which is suppressed in magnitude, that is the role of an attenuator. So attenuator basically are passive devices. Now what do we mean by passive devices? It is made up of connection of devices which are passive, right? Passive devices are resistors. So attenuators are basically passive devices which is obtained by interconnection of resistors, okay? And what is the role of an attenuator? The role of an attenuator is to introduce a specified loss, right? Many a times we are designing the attenuator. Designing the attenuator for what purpose? So that we achieve the desired attenuation. It's not that we connect an attenuator into circuit and it just does the job of attenuation without taking into consideration what is the output requirement. No, that is not what an attenuator is. We usually design an attenuator so that we get the required amount of attenuation. Try to understand. Attenuators are designed for what purpose? So that we get the desired attenuation at the output, right? Not a random attenuation. So attenuators are basically providing specified loss. That's why the word specified loss. It means that it is introducing a desired amount of loss, desired amount of suppression of current or the voltage in the circuit. So attenuators are playing one more role. We now look into this figure. Here is where your attenuator is, and here is the output of the attenuator which is going to some load, right? So what is this attenuator doing? This attenuator is placed between the source and the load. This attenuator is placed between the source and the load. So basically attenuator is also said to provide a kind of isolation between the source and the load, right? Because it is a kind of wall between the source and the load. So this attenuator is also isolating the source from the load. And by designing proper attenuators, we can achieve any degree of attenuation, right? Attenuation by an amount of 1 unit or a 2 unit or 3 units. You design your attenuator as per your particular requirement of your circuit, to what level you want suppression of the current or the voltage. Accordingly, the attenuators are designed. That is what is said, degree of attenuation. So degree of attenuation means we can design attenuators to get the desired level of attenuation in the output. Attenuators must provide correct input and output impedance as well as providing the required attenuation. What does this mean is, attenuators, as just discussed, is placed between the source and the load. Attenuators also playing the job of isolation. But what is important here, since we are introducing attenuator between the source and the load, right, this attenuator should not disturb the job of interconnection of the load, the source and the load. What is the source doing to the load? The source is providing a input driving current or an input driving voltage to the particular load. And when this is being done, attenuator should not disturb the job of the source and the load. For this, attenuator should provide a dual role, should play a dual role. Why we are saying it's a dual role? Because attenuators are basically inserted into the circuit. One reason is to give the attenuation. That is a basic reason. Attenuators are inserted into the circuit so that we get the desired attenuation. But At the same time, the attenuators which are forcefully inserted now into the circuit should play another very important role, and that is it should do impedance matching. Why should attenuator do impedance matching? There should be an impedance matching at the input side where you have connected the attenuator. So there should be an impedance matching between the source and the attenuator. There should also be an impedance matching between the attenuator and the load, right? So perfectly impedance matched network should be there between the source and the load, so that attenuator is not disturbing the overall operation of the source and the load. Only thing what attenuator should do here is provide the attenuation. If there is an impedance mismatch that is provided by the attenuator, then there will not be a maximum power transfer between the source and the load, because we know that when there is an impedance matching, we get maximum power transfer from the source and the load. So when we are inserting an attenuator between the source and the load, care has to be taken that the attenuator which is inserted here should have a perfect impedance matching, so that the operation of the source and the load is not disturbed. For that, a constant impedance attenuator is matched. This is very, very important. What we are doing here is we are providing a matching. This is very, very important. Constant impedance attenuator is matched to the source impedance ZI and load impedance Z0. So this attenuator is having an impedance which is matching with the source impedance ZI and load impedance Z0. So when there is an impedance matching, attenuator will simply transfer the voltage and the current to the load, providing the required attenuation, but there will not be further attenuation because of impedance mismatch. The only attenuation that should be provided is as per the design of the attenuator. But if this attenuator is not matching, is not doing impedance matching, then there will be an additional attenuation in the attenuator along with the design, along with the designed value of attenuation. And that additional attenuation is because of impedance mismatch. So this is very, very important that the attenuator that we are inserting into the circuit to provide the attenuation must have an impedance matching between the source impedance and the load impedance. Now let us look at the types of the attenuators. So there are basically four types of attenuators: T type of attenuator, pi type of attenuator, a lattice attenuator, and a bridge type of attenuator. We have already studied T type of two port networks, right? So this is a T type of attenuator. So you have three registers, and these three registers are connected in a T form, and this can be called, this particular circuit can be designed to work as an attenuator. If these three registers are connected as shown here in the form of a pi form, then we call it to be a pi attenuator. Third is the bridge type of attenuator. So here is a bridge type of attenuator, right? Bridge T type. So there is a bridge here. This is basically your T type of attenuator, and this is a bridge, additional bridge, and that's why it is called as a bridge T type of attenuator. And another is lattice type of attenuator, in which the structure is having a kind of lattice structure, and that's why it is called as a lattice attenuator. So there are basically four type of attenuators available, and each has its own characteristics. But when we are looking at these attenuators, what we basically now understand is attenuators are basically resistive networks. Right, all these are resistive networks, and that is the reason why we call attenuators to be passive networks, because they are all resistive networks. It's a circuit of resistive elements. That's why attenuators are passive devices, right? And all these interconnections of the registers are resulting into a two-port network, in which there is some input port and there is some output port. And therefore, attenuators are basically a two-port network. because as seen from the figures of the different types of attenuators, we see that each of these attenuators are similar to a two-port network, wherein we have some input port, we have some output port, where there are some input voltage, output voltage, and input currents and output currents. Therefore, attenuators in all these designs, attenuators are similar to a two-port network. Therefore, attenuators are basically a two-port network. And these attenuators are maybe symmetrical form or asymmetrical form, and can be either a fixed type of attenuator or a variable type of attenuator. So in these particular figures, if we are maintaining fixed resistor values, then we can say that these are fixed type of attenuators. If any of this resistor is made variable, then we can say that the attenuator is providing a variable attenuation, because the resistance value can be changed. As we change the resistance value, the attenuation provided by that attenuator changes, right? So there could be basically two types of attenuators, again fixed type of attenuator and variable type of attenuators. Fixed type of attenuators in which we have fixed value of resistors are basically known as pads. So it is as if you put a pad into your network, and that pad is doing a kind of attenuation job. Variable type of attenuators, as I just discussed, variable type of attenuators are the attenuators in which we can vary the resistor value. So as the resistor value is changed, we can get different attenuation provided by that attenuator. And variable attenuators are basically used where? To control the volume. So if you want to reduce the volume by different degrees, right? If you change the volume by one certain fixed value, that becomes a fixed type of attenuator. But if you want to control the volume for various different magnitudes, then you need to go for a variable type of attenuator, in which basically variable type of attenuators are used for controlling volumes, because volume control is a fine control, right? You need to do a fine precision as per your desired level of audacity, right? So that's why you need to control the volume systematically, and there is a need of variable attenuators. So attenuators are used in laboratories to obtain small value of voltage and current for testing purpose. So if we need a small value of voltage or a current for the circuit to be tested, then we pass that particular voltage and the current through an attenuator and get the desired level of voltage and the current for testing the circuits. Now let us go into some of mathematical details. Let us do some mathematical analysis to the attenuators. So basically, attenuators, I just discussed, they are doing the job of attenuation of the voltage or the current. So a better way would be to calculate the attenuation in terms of expressing it in terms of power. So this attenuation is basically measured in the units of decibels or in neppers. This is very important. We always measure attenuation with some unit, right? If we are decreasing the magnitude of the current, or we are decreasing the voltage of the circuit, right? Then this is to be expressed in terms of some unit. By what amount you have decreased the attenuation, if you have done the attenuation, it has to be expressed in terms of some unit, and the best unit expressed is decibels or in neppers. There are two units, either you go for decibel representation or in neppers, right? Both these are the units with which we can express the amount of attenuation done on the input, right? So attenuation is basically expressed in terms of in dB, as attenuation in dB is 10 log 10 of P1 by P2, where P1 is the input power and P2 is the output power of the two-port network or your attenuator. So attenuation is measured by taking the log of output, input by output, Okay, log of input by output. Here I have expressed input and output in terms of power of the two port network. And now what we know, we have just discussed that another role of two port network is to do impedance matching. So if we say that R0 is the characteristic impedance of the attenuator, so R0 is the overall resistance of the attenuator, then as just discussed, this R0 should be matching with the input port resistance, input terminal of the source, and output, that is the load of the attenuator. So therefore P1 and P2 can be expressed in terms of R0, that is the characteristic resistance of the attenuator, as I square R is the equation of power. So I1 square R0. So I1 square is the input port current, R0 is the input port resistance. Why is it input port resistance? Because as just discussed, attenuator should also provide impedance matching. So if we say that throughout the impedance is R0, so the resistance is R0 here. So I1 square R, or I square R, is basically the power equation. If I now talk about P1, that is in terms of input port parameters, the current becomes I1 and the characteristic resistance is R0. Similarly, P2, that is the output port power, will be the product of I2 square R0, right? So R0 gets cancelled, and now we can express P1 by P2 as I1 square by I2 square. Similarly, if I talk about power in terms of voltage, instead of I square R, we can write the power equation as V square by R. Power can be expressed as V square by R, right? So P1 becomes V1 square by R0, P2 becomes V2 square by R0. R0 gets cancelled. And P1 by P2 is the ratio of V1 square by V2 square. Both indicates the ratio of power, right? Under the assumption that we have placed the attenuator such that it is doing a perfect impedance matching. And that's why the impedance at the input port and the impedance at the output port is very, very same. It's a perfectly matched attenuator, and that's why I can take similar resistances at the input side and at the output side. Therefore, the ratio of power P1 at the port 1 to power P2 at port 2 will be the ratio of I1 square by I2 square, or in terms of voltage, if I express the power in terms of voltage, I get P1 by P2 as V1 square by V2 square, where V1, V2 are the input port and output port voltages. Now, if I express this in dB, if I express this in dB, then I need to take the log of it. It becomes 20 log 10 of V1 by V2. Or if I express it in terms of I1, I2, it becomes 20 log. Why is it 20 log? As you can just see, it was 10 log of P1 by P2. Now, instead of P1 by P2, we know that this P1 by P2 is nothing but I1 square by I2 square, or V1 square by V2 square. So, I1 square by I2 square, if I take that square, right, outside the log, it becomes 2 into 10, and that's why 20, right? I hope you're understanding this mathematics. So, P1 by P2, as just discussed, is nothing but I1 square by I2 square. So, if I take that square term outside log, it multiplies with 10 and it becomes 10 into 2. So, it becomes 20 log. And that's the reason why in this equation, you see 20 log of V1 by V2 and 20 log of I1 by I2. Both gives the same attenuation value, right? So this is attenuation expressed in dB. So this is the equation of attenuation expressed in dB. So if we now express, to have a simplified representation, if we now express the ratio V1 by V2 or I1 by I2 with N, if I express this ratio, if I call this ratio as N, then what equation do I get? P1 by P2 becomes N square. If I take the ratio I1 by I2 as N, then I can write P1 by P2 as N square. Similarly, if I take V1 by V2, if I call this V1 by V2 as N, then the ratio P1 by P2 becomes N square. So with this, the attenuation can now, instead of V1 by V2, now I can replace it as N. So this equation, which is attenuation expressed in dB, this equation gets modified to attenuation in dB is equal to 20 log 10 of n. So instead of V1 by V2 or instead of I1 by I2, we are calling this ratio as n. So n is the ratio of V1 by V2 or I1 by I2. So this equation of attenuation becomes 20 log 10 of n. Or if I reverse this particular operation, I get the equation in terms of n. So n becomes anti log of dB by 20. Right? So log, reverse of log is anti log. So anti log of dB divided by 20. So anti log of dB by 20 gives you n. So this is the equation in dB, or if you have to reverse this equation, you get the value of n with anti log of dB by 20. So this is the basic fundamentals behind every attenuator, whether it is T type of attenuator, whether it is pi type of attenuator, right? This is the basic mathematics behind the attenuators. Okay, now let us try to apply this mathematics onto the symmetrical T type of attenuator. Let us discuss symmetrical T type of attenuator. So, what is a symmetrical T type of attenuator? As just shown you, it's an attenuator with a T shape. So, what are the registers in the T type of attenuator? R1, R1, and R2. So, R1, R1, R2. All these three registers is the T type of attenuator. This R0 is the load. This attenuator is connected to some load, and that load has a resistance value R0. So basically, this is a symmetrical T-type of network with attenuators comprising of R1 and R2. So to design the symmetrical T-type of network, what we need to calculate is the R1 and R2 values. Once we get R1 and R2, we can design, it is as if we have designed a T-type of attenuator. Right? So here we'll start with, we are going to derive the equations for R1 and R2. So, for symmetrical T type of network, we'll say that this is a symmetrical T type of network comprising of R1 and R2 registers connected in a T shape, which is further connected to a load having load resistance R0. Now, let us apply KVL to analyze this T type of attenuator. Let us apply KVL. So, the KVL is applied with a view that the voltage across this terminal is nothing but the voltage across the two. So since these are in parallel, similar voltages apply, right, is seen at both ends. So voltage at this particular point from this node to this node is similar to the voltage from this node to this node, right? So what is the voltage at this particular, across this particular branch? What is the voltage? So voltage would be the resistor R2 into the current which flows through this branch. So what is the current which flows through this branch? Since this is a two-port network, attenuators are two-port networks, we assume the input current as I1, the output current as the current which flows through R1, R0 is taken to be I2, and if there is a current division that takes place here, the current that flows through R2 will be I1 minus I2. This is the current I1. If this is current I2, there is a current division which takes here, and that's why whatever current flows through this branch is nothing but I1 minus I2. So this, if this is the current that flows through this branch, what is the voltage across this branch? So it will be R2 into the current. So R2, I1 minus I2 is the voltage across this branch. Similarly, what is the voltage across this branch? The series resistance R1 and R0. The current that flows is I2. The total resistance is sum of R1 and R0. So the voltage across this branch is I2 into R1 plus R0 as seen here. And that's why the equation is this. So voltage at this, across this branch is nothing but the voltage across this branch. So voltage for this particular branch is taken as R2 into I1 minus I2, whereas voltage across this branch is I2 into R1 plus R0. So if we simplify this, we get some common terms for I1, collecting all the common terms of I1 and expressing the ratio as I1 by I2, because as just discussed, this ratio we are calling it as N. I1 by I2 or V1 by V2, we are using it this ratio as n. So I want to express this particular equation as ratio of I1 by I2. So rearranging the term as I1 by I2, we get a ratio which is this. R1 plus R0 plus R2 by R2 is nothing but the ratio I1 by I2. And this ratio we are calling it as n. Now look at what is the characteristic impedance of this T-type of attenuator. If I look at from this particular end, what is the overall resistance of this T-type of attenuator? So what we understand is R1 and R2 are in series. Can I say so? R1 and R2 are in series. So it is R1 plus R0. And this series resistance is in parallel with R2. Right? Observe, understand that we are looking into this particular circuit from this particular end. So if I look into the circuit from this end, what is the overall resistance of this T-type of attenuator? So what we understand is these two resistances come in series, and this series combination of the resistance is in parallel with R2, and this parallel combination is further in series with R1. So this we are expressed in mathematical form as shown here, right? So what we have done first is we have added R1 plus R0. Now this R1 plus R0 is in parallel with R2. So what would be the equation of parallel combination of R2 parallel with R1 plus R0? Will be R2 into R1 plus R0 divided by R2 plus R1 plus R0. So this is the overall parallel combination of these three resistors, which is in further series with R1. So R1 plus the parallel combination of this, and this, the equation which we get is this. So R1 is in series with the parallel combination of R1 plus R0 in parallel with R2. So this is the overall R0 of the T type of network terminated with the load resistance R0. Now what we do next is, in the next step, we have an equation in which we have R1 plus R0 plus R2 divided by R2, and this ratio we are calling it as N. Can I identify this ratio in the equivalent resistance that we have just expressed? Yes, we have these terms R1 plus R0 plus R2 divided by R2 in this overall characteristic impedance. You could see here R1 plus R0 plus R2 divided by R2. We identify that term here. So it is nothing but 1 by N, and that's why we can introduce N into this equation. So what we now get when we introduce N into this equation will be R0 is equal to R1 plus R1 plus R0 divided by N. If we replace this term R1 plus R0 plus R2 divided by R2 as seen here by N, we get an equation as shown here. So R0 becomes R1 plus R0 divided by N. So we have inserted N into this equation. So we'll cross multiply in the next step. We'll cross multiply. So NR0, NR1 becomes R1 plus R0, collecting R1 terms, collecting R0 terms. We get R1 expressed in terms of load resistance R0 and N. N is the ratio of either I1 by I2 or V1 by V2. So this way we have obtained the first resistance value of the T network. Similarly, now we have to proceed and obtain the equation of R2 to design the attenuator, right? What we intend to do here, we are intended to design a symmetrical T type of network. And this is the circuit of a symmetrical T type of network. So to completely design the attenuator, we need the value of R1 and we need the value of R2. With the first step, we have now obtained the equation of R1. Similarly, we'll proceed next. So as discussed initially, this was the equation by obtaining the KVL. We had applied KVL. So we had this equation, I1 by I2, R1 plus R0 plus R2 by R2 is equal to N. Now I'll use this equation. From this equation, I get the equation of R2. So I'll cross multiply. So I get NR2 is equal to R1 plus R0 plus R2. Collecting the R2 terms, I have N minus 1 into R2 is equal to R1 plus R0. Now we already know R1 from the previous step. If I go to previous step, we already know R1, right? So what we can do, we can substitute R1 here. And that's what we have done here. We have kept this part as it is, but R1, which we have already derived in the previous step, this is the R1 which we have derived in the previous step. This R1 we will substitute here, right? So we'll continue with this equation. And instead of R1, we'll replace this R1 with what we have derived in the previous step, as R1 is R0 n minus 1 by n plus 1 plus this R0 as it is. So we'll simplify this. What we get is R2. So this is the way we have got R1, we have got R2. For the symmetrical T-type network. With this information of R1 and R2, we can easily design the two-port network. So let us do a small example here. So the problem is, design a T-pad attenuator to give an attenuation of 60 dB. So whatever attenuator we are going to design should give us an attenuation of 60 dB and to work on a line of 500 ohm impedance. It means that this attenuator is connected to a line where there is a 500 impedance. You know, we have a load resistance. We have to connect this attenuator to a load resistance whose impedance value is 500. So the very first thing is to carefully understand the problem statement. What does the problem statement say? It says that we are going to do attenuation. We are going to design an attenuator, which is a T type of attenuator. And that attenuator should provide us an attenuation of 60 dB. This attenuator should give you an attenuation of 60 dB. And this attenuator is connected to a line where there is a 500 ohm impedance. It means that the characteristic impedance of the line where you are going to connect the attenuator, that characteristic impedance of that line is 500 ohms. So let us start to design. What we know, we have taken a variable n, which is the ratio of I1 by I2 or V1 by V2. And we know now that this n can be obtained by taking the anti-log of d by 20, where d is the attenuation given in dB. Right, so n is nothing but the anti-log of d by 20. How much is the attenuation we need? We need a 60 dB of attenuation. So this 60 by 20, anti-log of which gives us 1000 value. So n, which is the ratio of I1 by I2, is 1000. So now we know what is this 500 ohms is the characteristic impedance of the line, which is nothing but R0. This is R0, this is n. The ratio of I1 by I2 is n. So now we can easily calculate R1 and R2 with the design equations which we just derived. So R1 is, the equation of R1 that we just derived was R0 into n minus 1 by n plus 1. So let us substitute R0. R0 is a characteristic impedance which is 500 ohms. So R0 is 500 ohms. N we have already calculated is 1000. So substituting those values, we get R1 to be 499 ohms. Similarly, let us calculate R2. So R2, the equation of R2 is 2n by n square minus 1. Right? If we substitute here into R0. It should be into R0, right? So if we substitute everything, we get R2 to be 1 ohms. So R1 is nearly 500 ohms, R2 is 1 ohm. So we have obtained the attenuator. So what we got, R1 to be 500 ohms, R2 to be 1 ohm. So we need two 500 ohm resistances and a resistance, shunt resistance of 1 ohms, right? With this, we have designed a symmetrical T-type network. Similarly, friends, now